And as you also may have noticed, I lived in Sweden. And I had the wonderful opportunity to live in Sweden for 6 years. And I taught at two different bilingual schools, first as an English teacher, and then as an assistant principal. And during my time there, I really saw some wonderful things being done in education. And when I came back to teach in the States in 2015, I was filled with questions. What are all these standardized tests about? Why are we teaching to the test? Why are we so focused on these results that our students are making? And it really inspired me to do this study. Why did this switch all the way to the end of my slideshow?
That's silly. We saw the whole thing.
Yeah.
I guess you guys are done, and so am I.
Very nice.
Well, let's just go back a little bit. There we go.
I think you have to press next instead of play.
Oh, thank you. I don't know So I chose this area of research because of my time in Sweden. So I thought that it would be nice to research differentiation and to see if the things that I saw in Sweden actually works the same way in the United States. I also chose science because of my own experiences with science. When I was hired and I was told that I would be teaching science to middle schoolers, I freaked out. I am not a science person. My science knowledge is average at best, and I remember in middle school starting to dislike science and then eventually hating it by the time I finished senior high school. So I wanted to make sure that the attitude that I developed did not get passed down to the girls that I was teaching. And I also have a tendency to teach a little bit outside of the box. I don't like to teach from the book. So my coworkers and I in fifth grade always talk about, you know, how we are all very different. We have very different styles of teaching, ways of doing things, and that we're all on different pages. And one of my coworkers joked to me, "Julie, not only are you not on the same page as us, you haven't even opened the book yet." True, language arts book is still in the cupboard. It's April. So these strong feelings are why I chose differentiated instruction and focusing on how girls can use that differentiation to improve their confidence and their achievement. So before I could really answer the question, can this improve their achievement and confidence, I needed to do some research. And when I was researching, I wanted to know what is differentiation and what is it not. Because there are these myths out there that say, oh, differentiation, you need to make sure that each kid has an individualized lesson. No. You need to make sure that you're teaching to learning styles. Kind of. Multiple intelligences. Yes, that's part of that. But differentiation, Carol Tomlinson wrote it best when she equated it to parents, parenting. So how many of you are parents in the audience? When you think about your own children, are they exactly the same? No. They're in the same household, they have the same parents, they're part of the same family, but you have to treat them kind of differently. Yes, you have the same values, the same structure for them, but you go at things a little bit differently with each child. And the same is true in a classroom. Why should we differentiate our instruction? It's so much easier to just have a book and they all get the book and they all learn from the same book, and that's how it should be done, right? Well, that would be wonderful, but we know not all kids learn that way. A lot of kids become very bored because they don't like sitting and looking at a book. They don't like answering questions on a piece of paper. Boredom leads to disengagement, and disengagement on the extreme level leads to dropping out. I found research that said that every 9 seconds a student in the United States drops out of school. That is terrifying. And the reason, the number one reason that was cited for dropping out was that they were bored. Now, is this a valid excuse for not learning? According to Patricia Wolf, how many of you have read Brain Matters through your learning community classes? Excellent book. Patricia Wolf said that boredom is actually a biological barrier to learning, because when the brain is not engaged, when it's thinking that these facts are useless, it discards them. So according to Patricia Wolf, it actually is a valid excuse for not learning. Can we learn something about differentiation from other countries? When we look at the United States, we're obviously not there yet. What are other countries doing? I looked at Finland, And Finland has been at the top of all international test scores since about the year 2000. And they accidentally did that. They do not focus on test scores at all. They actually only have one standardized test their entire schooling, and that is at the end of their final year, as opposed to us who test all the time. Finnish teachers are also required to spend less time at school.
Woohoo!
They have more time to collaborate with their colleagues. They have more time to sit and evaluate or think about curriculum. Not all this time in front of the class where they can't get anything done. They also follow their students from year to year. So you know how it is at the beginning of the year. I see some kindergarten teachers in the audience. Seeing all these new faces, you meet them, you have a year with them, and then they're gone. So you finally found what works for these kids, and then they're passed up to the next grade. In Finland, many teachers follow their class for a few years, so they develop these relationships and they see what works with student A. We all have that difficult kid in our class where we finally get them about April, and then the school year is over. Sweden also is a country that has a lot of great things going on in education. Their national tests are actually graded by the teacher. So instead of you giving your students, how many of you are in MCA mode right now? They sit at the computer, they click some buttons, they press submit, and their results go off to someone else, and all of their language and reading is evaluated by how they clicked buttons on the computer screen. In Sweden, when we did the English test, we had four different parts of it, and I, as their English teacher, got to evaluate how they did. So I sat down with them and had them speak to me, and I got to evaluate how are you doing according to the national rubric. Sitting down with my colleagues after the national test was over, we had a recording of the students speaking, and we could assess them together as teachers. It was a wonderful way of doing things. There are things that other countries are doing that we can learn from. Now, what groups benefit most from differentiation? We have kids in our classroom that are going to learn no matter what. I was one of those students. I liked school. I sat at my desk, I did my worksheets, I learned. That's a very small percentage of our population. We have a lot of other kids that don't just want to sit and learn. And some of them actually can't do exactly that. Think about ELL students. When we have these kids in our classroom, they might be able to comprehend what we're giving them, but they can't produce something, an answer, orally or on paper. So we can't assess their knowledge. They need differentiation. Kids with low socioeconomic status. We have those kids in our district, some of us a lot. When we give them a homework assignment, they don't have the resources, they don't have the support at home. They need some sort of differentiation. And a surprising group is actually girls in STEM. So the science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Those girls are actually underachieving. And I've got a short video to show you about that.
I'm really passionate about climate change. I'm worried that there won't be enough fresh water for everybody. My interest is to find a cure for cancer because my mom had it.
There's always going to be someone that says, like, no, you can't do it.
I think I can. I want my name to be there and be like, Marley, you want to help stop this climate change issue.
I will discover a cure for breast cancer.
So the statistics are out there that girls are underperforming, they're not as involved, and the question that I was trying to find is, why is that? Well, first of all, when we think about our society, we're kind of creating these gender stereotypes. When kids are little, and I think they just stopped having like the boy toy aisle and the girl toy aisle. building things and creating things and solving problems. We can also think about how the boys are in our classrooms. Boys are usually a little bit louder. We tend to call on them more when they have their hands up. Girls are more likely to sit back and not be so dominant. When we have experiments, the boys are more likely to take control of the experiments and the girls are left on the sidelines. And the third thing is, fifth grade is the beginning of middle school. This is where peer pressure really, really starts to get intense. And as peer pressure increases, their confidence decreases. They're not willing to put their hand up and participate because they might be wrong, that loud boy is going to call them stupid, and they're going to get embarrassed. These are the trends that we're seeing, so girls are becoming less and less involved. This is something that I personally saw as well in myself, and it's why I feel very strongly on getting girls confident and achieving high results in science. So as I said, I started teaching last year in Park Rapids, and when I was teaching, I saw that the things that I was doing in my classroom, these outside of the book, outside of the box things, were actually getting girls excited, and they were getting me excited as well. I don't like science. It's not that exciting for me. There are some things that I'm looking at, and I'm like, I'm not even interested in talking about this. Why do I want to teach someone else these things? So I wanted to get started right away and not have my girls wasting time not learning science in a good way. So what I did to begin my research was I administered a pretest. I wanted to find my girls that were struggling. I didn't want to wait until I had weeks and weeks of school and weeks of results already. I wanted to start right away. So I made up a test with questions based on the fourth grade standards, earth science, physical science, life science. And after that, I gave the entire class also a survey about how they felt about science. How much do you like science on a scale of 1 to 5? How good are you at science on a scale of 1 to 5? Who likes science? Who is good at science? Why do we need science? So when I got the test results and the results from the survey, I identified 3 girls who were low achieving on the assessment and who had low confidence and really negative answers on their survey. I had a participant group then of 3 fifth grade girls, and throughout the course of the year, I just started right away with my differentiated instruction. I didn't want to teach the traditional textbook way because that's not my way of teaching, and I thought that it would be a disservice to the students. So I taught differentiation right from the start of Unit 1, and I will give you more details about those later. As I was teaching, I took anecdotal notes on the girls. I recorded when they were engaged, when they were participating. I wrote down some of the comments that they made, some of the facial expressions that I saw, some of the body language. I also had them write in science journals, and this was a big thing for me because the research that I had done said a lot about girls being really unwilling to put themselves out there, especially in middle school. We don't like being wrong. We don't like being embarrassed in front of our peers. So every day they got a question and they got to write about it just in their science journals. And they got to not have to put themselves out in front of the class. A non-threatening way for them to show me what they knew. I also had a written assessment after each unit. And I assessed the students on what I had taught them, but also how I had taught them the information. And I'll give you an example of that later. When I was done with the 12 weeks, I gave them a survey again that was identical to the one at the beginning to see, did you answer differently? Do you now like science a little bit? How is your confidence in science? And I analyzed the data. So here were the 3 units that I did, some of the activities. We had an introduction to the scientific method. It's kind of dry. You open the book and you see, here are the steps of the scientific method. First you have a question, then you form a hypothesis, and the kids got really bored by that. So what we did was we did lots of experiments. I gave them random things and said, here, figure something out with this. So one day I went to the candy machine at lunchtime, I bought a packet of sprees, I found some cups in my classroom, and I said, I don't care what you do, here a couple sprees, here's a cup. You make up some sort of question and conduct an experiment. So these girls were seeing what the spree did in water and making up hypotheses and testing that out. We did a lab with our science inquiry tools. So instead of saying, raise your hand if you know what a balance is. What is a balance used for? We had a little station set up where they got to experiment with different things, using tape measures and yardsticks to measure how far they could throw paper airplanes rather than just teaching them that this is a way that we measure things. We did a scavenger hunt with the inquiry tools. So using the balance to answer a question to get to the next station. The kids liked that. They were using the tools. They understood what the tools were used for, but they were having fun and didn't realize that they were learning. And one of my favorite things to do is a tipspromenad, and this is a Swedish activity. It's very strange. There are even adults that do this on the weekend in their free time, and it just baffles me. But they have this thing where they post questions, and it's usually out in the forest. So I would go running on a trail, and there would be papers stuck to trees, and Swedish people walking along. Y'all, what do you do? They love going around and doing these walking quizzes where they ask, where they answer questions that they find. So I do these with the kids because it gets them moving. They think that it's fun to get out of their desk. We usually go in the hallway or outside, and they get to walk around and write down the answers. They're not sitting at a desk. They don't realize that this is a question that I might ask them anyway on a piece of paper at their desk. They think that it's fun. So I'm going to have you do a tipspromenad. Hopefully I have enough question papers for everyone. So what you need to do is you'll take one of these answer papers and a pencil. I have some more pencils if you don't have anything to write with. And you go from question to question. You don't have to start at question one, because if everyone starts on question one, then we're going to have chaos. This is how we do it with the kids too. You start on different questions, write the letter in the correct blank, make sure that all the questions are answered, they're around the room, and when you have everything answered, you may sit down. So, come up, get an answer paper and pencil.
An advantage.
Sorry, there was no camera set up when I put that question over there. So now you have to creep in on the camera and answer that question.
Okay, it's proof to the audience that there wasn't
someone here.
Oh my God, I'm gonna stretch you out.
No, but they might be one off and then they're devastated, even though I never grade the tipspromenad, because usually the questions are made by them, so they're not all valid anyway.
Oh, my answers are wrong!
It's so sad because this means nothing, but. Hand in your answer papers, I'll be sure to file them somewhere important. It's my recycling bin. remember the answer. Kristen.
It's Julie Kelly.
It's sure. Kelly A. Question number two. Where does the presenter teach? I tried to throw you off on this in the beginning. Robin.
Park Rapids.
Park Rapids. The correct answer is C. Which of the following is not the name of one of the presenter's children? A. Nolan. B. Leon. Or C. Liam. Kristen.
B. Leon.
B. Leon. Funny story. My 91-year-old neighbor is convinced that my son's name is Leon and gives him birthday cards addressed to Leon. Doesn't matter how many thank you cards we send back, it's still Leon, but whatever. Close enough, she's 91. I'll give it up. In which country did the presenter previously live? A. Switzerland. B. Finland. C. Sweden. Everyone should be able to answer this. On three. One, two, three.
Sweden.
Thank you. I don't remember my questions. What is one of the presenter's passions? A. Eating Chinese food. B. Playing the bongos. Or C. Running marathons. On three. One, two, three.
C.
Running marathons. Even though I was in percussion for like all my high school career, I have no rhythm, apparently. I think the bongos would probably be fun. What group did the presenter target for her research? A. Girls with low confidence. B. Boys with too much confidence. Or C. Random students on the street. A. Because I would have gotten in trouble probably for C. Park Rapids and no one goes on the street because it's too cold there. My second unit was cells. And again, last year when I saw this unit, I was like, oh my gosh, that's so boring. I don't even understand cells. How do I make this interesting? So we did a cells tips from that, and I had the kids write the questions. After they understand how to do this, they write their own questions. So if there's a day where we get done something early or I really am not prepared with anything, I'll say, okay, think about what we learned yesterday. You write a question, and we're going to do a tips from an app. It kills the whole lesson time because they're writing questions down. They're getting ready and putting them up outside or in the hallway, and they're going through and answering questions. It's a lifesaver if you haven't planned properly. This make a cell activity, I got a picture of my girls doing this. Last year, when I was doing the cell thing, I was teaching them, and I'm like, oh my gosh, they don't understand this, and I'm bored too. So I just started picking up random things from my classroom, and I had them become a cell. So I found some masking tape, some scotch tape, a water jug, I found some candy, and they each had to come up and become this cell. So the cell wall was the masking tape, and the cell membrane was the scotch tape, so I had them holding that up on the outside. And then I picked my really loud kid, because every class has a really loud kid, and I whispered in his ear, okay, you're going to run around. And so I had my loud kid going around like, do this! Run over here! Stop that! Go up here! And he was the nucleus. I had my really hyper kid take a bag of candy, and she just ran around with the bag of candy. She was the mitochondria that had all the energy. And when we did this, even the kids that weren't participating, I had them all do it at one point, but even the kids that weren't participating remembered. They're like, oh yeah. I know what the nucleus was. It was so-and-so. He was yelling at everybody. Oh, I remember. I got to be the mitochondria because I got to run around with the candy. So it was a good way for them to make an abstract concept a little bit more concrete. We also did a plant cell lab where they looked at plant cells under the microscope, and it was cells to body systems. So they had to study organs and how the organs work together in body systems. And I thought that it would be good. Last year my kids had, 32 minutes for lunch and recess combined. So they were outside for like 10 minutes getting activity, hardly at all. And by the afternoon when we had science, they were crazy. So I thought, what better way to teach how the circulatory system works and how to see how our heart works than getting our heart moving. So we learned about max heart rates, calculating our target heart rate, And then I had them create these HIIT workouts, high intensity interval training, so that we could get our heart rate up in a short amount of time, calculate what our heart rate was, and teach other people. So they each group had to create a workout. It couldn't involve any equipment. It had to be something they could do in the classroom. So here's an example of one of the workouts. Oops, sorry about that. They created for us.
Hello, we are students from 5F. We will be showing you our exercises we made in the science class.
You will need no equipment except for a wall.
We will be showing you ABC push-ups, aces, Z, side lunge, cherry pickers, karaoke in place, wall sit knee touch, squat twist, frog jump, running place.
First, we will be doing ABC push-ups, ABC.
So if I were really mean, I would be making you do this right now. People that are presenting today would be mad at me for making you all sweaty, and I won't make you do that. But it was great because at the end of the video, they explained how to calculate target heart rate, so they all understood that. And it also served another purpose. Now, when I have kids that have too much energy, or we have extra time at the end of the day, or the kids are inside during recess time, we just put one of these workouts on. I've uploaded them all to my private YouTube, so they're not published to, you know, the world to see, but we can go on and choose a workout, and they love that because they get to be the trainer for the day. So, ooh, my workout video is up today. Everyone gets to do the exercises that I told them to do. So I have a ton of those that I can use at any time now. And when I did the assessment, I always make my own assessments, but I made this one very personalized. I drew little stick people because my drawing is not very good when we acted out the cell so that they could match the person to what part of the cell it was. So I had this little stick man saying, do this, do that. And they had to match, okay, what part of the cell was that? That was the nucleus because that's the boss. That was my part of my assessment. And it's important for me to match what I've done and how I've done it to how they are being assessed. Then my last unit was the classification of living things. And this is the unit last year that made me want to rip my hair out. Because I opened the book and it was right before we had a master's weekend. And I was like, oh my gosh, kingdom, phylum, class, or family, genus, species is the most boring thing ever, and why do any of us care about this? Luckily, as I said, it was the weekend right before, it was right before we were going to have class, and Denny, our instructor, taught us this cool thing where we had different touch points on our body to remember ways to, like, healthy foods or something like that. So I came up with, in my car, I think, when I was driving home, ways to teach kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species using touch points. So I taught my class this, and it's a really cute video. I have to show you.
Kingdom, yes! Phylum, yes!
Closed, and he had to keep his door closed, and we had to see if he could hear us. And then we had to see if the secretary, who was like way down the hallway from us, could hear. I lied about that. There was no way she could hear. She was like 200 yards away, and her door was closed. But, oh, yep, Sherry heard you. Great job. They loved doing this, and now it's ingrained in their mind. So when they were doing the assessment, and I didn't give them any hints about this, I just said, think about our chant. I could see them at their desks, and I told them, you can't say it out loud, think it in your head. So I would watch them. And they would be doing it in their head, and I think I only had one kid get one of those wrong, which is amazing. They also came up with with mnemonic devices. I got that idea from Brain Matters. So they had to think of something, a word that started with a K for kingdom and P, phylum. So they came up with different silly sentences. And one of the classes last year came up with K poops corn on family's game setup. It was last year, and I still remember that, and so do they, especially Kate, because it wasn't his group that came up with it. But they don't forget that because it was funny to them to think about somebody pooping corn, obviously. And then I realized they understood this chant really well, but they didn't understand why we were sorting things. Why do we have things in the Kingdom Final Plus? So we talked about Walmart, because everyone knows Walmart, especially in Park Rapids. It's the only thing that we really have there. So we talked about Walmart and how we sort things in Walmart. Because you don't want to find your underwear in the meat section. You want to go in the clothing section. That would be weird to find your underwear in the meat section. We played a sort of game, and they still want to play this all the time. So I would look around the room, and I'm not going to make you do this, but I would look at them, and then I would point to a different corner where they were supposed to go. And they were supposed to think about how I was sorting them. So I did hair color, eye color, shoe type, syllables and last names. That one they didn't get. That was the only way I could trick them. Thinking about how we sort things in the real world. They invented invertebrates. So invertebrates are super boring, I think. I don't want to learn about annelids. But when they could make their own annelid or echinoderm, this one here is a, this is an echinoderm called squiggle. So they had some features of a real echinoderm, and then they had their own cool things that squiggle could do. This, I don't remember what he was called. He was an arthropod. Then the kids, it meant something to them because they remembered their little thing that they made up. And we also reviewed with a Kahoot, and I had the kids write their own questions. How many of you are familiar with Kahoot? Kahoot is a wonderful, wonderful quiz game online. You get to import all the questions. There are some pre-made ones, but I don't use them because they're not necessarily things that apply to what we're doing. But I had the kids write up a question in pairs. I typed them all into the Kahoot. And let me tell you, if you have boys that are not engaged, I know this is a presentation about girls, but the boys absolutely love it. It's competitive, it's on a Chromebook or some sort of device. They are screaming. Again, they're super competitive. Oh, I clicked the wrong thing! And they're so upset that they didn't get that question right when it doesn't really matter because I'm not grading how well they did on their Kahoot. I have that if any of you teach vertebrates and invertebrates. It's kind of a specific topic, but if you have that topic, I have a Kahoot made up of it. After I taught for these 12 weeks, I wanted to see, I mean, we had fun. So I thought, well, if nothing else, at least I enjoyed it and the kids seemed to have fun. I looked at their assessments and I was blown away. From the first assessment to the third assessment, the girls in my participant group improved 11.63%. On the first assessment, they were performing below the rest of their class, 9.9 percentage points below. By the third assessment, they were only 3.3 percentage points below the rest of their group, or below the rest of the class. And by the end of the study, and this is a really cool part, the girls in my participant group were actually achieving higher results than the average student in a traditional classroom. I was so impressed, so proud of these girls for that result. And here's the graph that illustrates. I also looked at their science journals. I had a rubric in which I assessed this. Level 4.0 meant that they were fully understanding the concepts and they could apply it to real life. Level 1 is no, they're not getting it. As you can see in Unit 1, Student A and Student B were really not producing very much at all that I could. Getting it. You're not showing me that you get the concepts that we're going over, the vocabulary, and you cannot apply this to the real world. By the third unit, I mean, student three was high achieving overall to begin with, but you can see even student A and student B, who struggled a lot more, they were actually showing me that they understood things by the last minute. I was also really impressed with their surveys. So at the beginning, their surveys were really negative. They had ranked themselves on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being I'm absolutely really bad at science, or 5 I'm great, I'm an excellent student at science. You can see that they did not think very highly of themselves. By the end, their perceptions of themselves were much higher. And they also commented on things differently. So on the first survey, I gave them parts where they could answer questions and describe science. Very, 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 very boring. Okay? Who needs to know science? Just scientists. Why might I need to know science? In case it's on a test. Those were their answers. By the end, they were saying, one student wrote, science is really fun. I actually like it now. Science is much better when it's from Mrs. Kelly rather than the book. Things like that made me feel like, okay, yes, their assessments showed improvement, but they also are liking science more and thinking that they're better at science, which is a huge accomplishment. I took anecdotal notes, as I said, about the girls. Tally mark when I saw them engaged. So engagement to me was, do you look like you're here with us? If the head was on the desk, if they didn't have any of their supplies up, that was a no. And as you can see at the beginning, especially student B, there's not a lot of engagement. There's a lot of head on desk, nothing out. By the end, they were all engaged at least a few times during the lesson. I also looked at participation, which is a step above just being there and being with us. Are you giving us something? Are you raising your hand? Are you answering questions on your paper? Are you doing the lab with your group, or are you standing out to the side? And again, at the beginning, you can't even see some of these because they're at the bottom. They were not participating. They did not want to put their hand up. They did not want to be doing something in the experiment. But by the end, they were actually involved in doing something. And here are my conclusions. The girls can show higher academic results when the lessons are differentiated, when they are given different ways of showing their knowledge. They're more apt to participate and demonstrate confidence when science instruction is modified. So I had much more success with getting them to give me something instead of me just asking questions and saying, please raise your hand if you know the answer. You guys felt it at the beginning. You were not super comfortable because you don't know me. This is weird for you. You're not used to being a student. The girls that I had were used to just being in the background. And when they had a way to do things in a different way, it was much easier for them. And all students, regardless of gender and ability, showed higher results when the lessons were differentiated. So you can see on the graph, every time that we took the class average, it was higher than the traditional class average in the same topics. Here are my limitations. This is not the perfect study. It is by no means scientific because it was produced by me and I'm not a sciencey person. It was only 12 weeks long, which in the grand scheme of things is not a very long amount of time. I also only evaluated one area of one subject. I had life science. So one subject, but also just a very narrow focus in that. We're doing physical science right now. It would be really interesting to see if the girls would have the same results when they're doing chemistry like we're doing right now. I'm not sure. It would be interesting to see. My participant group was 3 students. It's a small group. But when I was taking my anecdotal notes, I needed a small group in order to actually see what these girls were doing. And there is not a ton of cultural diversity in the school district. I didn't take the statistics from my personal class, but in the district, 88% of the students are white, so there's not a ton of cultural diversity. It would be interesting to see in a classroom with more diverse learners. Now, I know not all of you are science teachers, so I have some other examples of differentiation, some ideas that maybe you can take back, and I've printed some of these resources as well. In language arts, this kind of happened by an accident, and I can actually thank Rebecca for some of these. I was going to do something with toilet paper rolls and paper towel rolls, and I had something planned for just a small group, and then I got probably 800 of these. A lot of them were from Rebecca, because I just emailed all the teachers. If you have some extra toilet paper rolls, you know, the cardboard tubes laying around, please give them to me. And with 800 of them, I needed to figure out something to do with them because some people had collected them meticulously. I'm not going to throw them away. So we made noun towels, and it was the most fun way of teaching grammar that I've ever found. I wanted to get students really involved with the nouns and the different types of nouns, plural nouns, possessive nouns, proper nouns, common nouns. So they got to make noun towels, and I had really no guidelines at all. I told them which nouns they had to use, and they had to make up a town. You can see they're very different. This one is Swedesville, so they made a town that was Swedish, and it was cute. They tried to Google Translate the words, and it didn't translate properly, but whatever. None of them were curse words, so that was a plus. This one had, they had crazy hats. There was one group that made a wedding. Some of the boys' groups made like rockets and whatever they wanted to make to show me all these different noun types. And they had so much fun with them. And it was a complete disaster outside of my classroom when they were building these, but they loved it, and now they remembered. If they say, what's a noun? I just look at them, like, noun. Oh yeah, because everything in their noun town was a noun. Now they remember what those are. So if they go to sixth grade and don't remember nouns, I'm gonna be really angry. Reading. When they're doing reading, yes, I use comprehension questions, but I don't believe in just having them answer questions to show their knowledge. So I had last year, this was actually one of my difficult EBD students. He meticulously made a classroom to emulate the Wayside School classroom, and you can see the amount of detail. He had the kids' desks and like different things from the book because he loved making things out of paper, which usually were to like distract the rest of the class. But here, he harnessed that to make a classroom. They read the book Loser by Jerry Spinelli, and they had to, one of their options that they had for the end of the book assessment was to create a board game and use information about the characters and the plot. And as you can see, they did a really good job with that, really cool games, and they actually liked playing that. Even my son Liam likes to play that. Games, even though he's four and has not read the book, obviously. Here are some books that I used when I was doing my research. You may want to jot these down for your own knowledge. This one had a lot of actual ideas of how you can use differentiated activities. I used it just for information, but I plan someday when I have a little more free time take some of her ideas and actually implement them. Carol Tomlinson has excellent information and ideas. Brain Matters, I've told you, is the book that really changed the way I think about teaching. Another book by Carol Tomlinson. And then if you want to go more specific, this was a PDF that you can find online. It had a lot of excellent information about girls and how, you know, from elementary age, actually before elementary, through college, how they're achieving in math, science, technology, and engineering, and also looking at what they're doing in Finland. Because you can get some cool ideas even though our entire system is not going to follow the Finnish system. You might find that some of the things they do there might work in your own classrooms. Do you have any questions? I have some resources if you want to take them. If you teach language arts and you would like some ideas about my noun town, I have those here. I have some rubrics for some novels that I've done. You can, you know, if you actually teach Loser or Indian in the Cupboard, you can just apply this directly, but you can take some of the ideas about the options that I've given them, diaries and board games and vlogs, vertebrates and invertebrates, Kahoot if you teach that, and also if you want to do your own tips per minute, I've made answer sheets that you can just copy and use in your classrooms. I have 27 kids in my class, so I've got 28 boxes that I've cut out for when we make our own. Thank you guys for coming. Hopefully you guys